There was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. To him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I'm here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise, go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in, putting his hand on him, that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard many of this man, how much evil he had done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, watch, for he is a chosen vessel unto me. Can you say it with me? A chosen vessel. God chose him. He's a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Somebody say it with me. I'm going to use him mightily. Well, my mic on. I'm going to use him mightily. I got about three of you. How about let's try 80%. I'm going to use him mightily. Yeah, there it is. I'm going to use him mightily. That's what he said, is it not? Huh? For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Father, we thank you tonight. I pray, Lord, help me to do a good job. Help me to preach this word. I pray, Lord, that you'd bring us into one mind and one accord and give us a heart to receive tonight. I need you tonight, Lord. Lord, I know I got me a word. This word's been on me about 3 weeks. I pray the atmosphere would be right for this word. I pray for discernment, sensitivity in us, Lord. I ask these things through the authority of Jesus' name. And somebody say amen. Can you put your Bible down and lift your hands and love the Lord here tonight? Amen. Let's get ready for the word of the Lord. Can we do that? Amen. Let's love the Lord together. Can we do that? Hallelujah. Father, we give you praise. Father, we give you praise. Father, we give you praise. Lord, we give you praise. How's that knee feeling, Brother Shelton? Still feeling good? Woo, glory to God. Lord, we love you so much. Father, in Jesus' name, you may be seated here in the presence of the Lord. The Lord said, I'm going to use this young man mightily. I'm going to send him before kings. I'm going to send him before mighty people. He's going to bear my name. He said, but I want to show him the things that he must suffer for my name's sake. There is a high cost to being used by God and fulfilling your destiny. Now, before every one of us, there is a cost that stands before us tonight. Especially to those of us who feel something in our heart and in our spirit that God wants to use us for his glory. I hope that I got some people in here tonight that feel a call of God that comes from the Spirit of God that's weighing up on your heart tonight. Man can't call you into this. Your dad can't call you. Your grandpa can't call you. Only the Spirit of God can call you to do a work for his name's sake. And when he calls you, he puts a weight upon your heart that I must do what God wants me to do. Does anybody feel in their heart tonight that God didn't just save you to save you, but I'm a chosen vessel and God wants to do something great in my life tonight? Is there anybody that feels that way? Is there anybody that feels tonight that God wants to do something great in this church? Greater than what we see right now. That there's something of destiny, something, amen, beyond. That's calling us to something deeper. Do you feel that tonight? There's a cost to that. There's a cost to fulfilling your destiny. And may I say to you tonight, it may cost you everything. It may cost you everything to get to where God wants you to be. When you look at those who God used in the scripture, there was always a price tag with it. They always paid a mighty price tag to be used by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, I want you to understand tonight, I'm not talking about going to heaven. Jesus paid that price for us to go to heaven, but he did not pay the price for us to be used by God. Every individual who's ever going to be used of God has got to pay their own price that God has set before them to pay. I'm thinking about Mary tonight, where the angel of the Lord visited her, and I love this because the angel came into her and said unto her, "Hail, thou art highly favored." Can you say it with me? Thou art highly favored. Thou art chosen. Hey, Paul, I picked you, Paul, because I'm going to use you. Now I'm going to show you how you're going to suffer for me. Mary, you're highly favored. Oh, my. And I'm going to put a seed in you that's going to break the back of the devil. It's going to change the destiny of humanity. No child has ever been born like this child. No one will ever do what this child is going to do. You are highly favored, Mary. Watch. And yet she wasn't married. And the Bible said that she was found. Say it with me. She was found with child. That word found means discovered. So she didn't broadcast with her mouth, "Hey, I'm pregnant." She didn't tell nobody she was pregnant. You know how they found out she was pregnant? She got where she couldn't hide the baby that was growing in her belly. Her husband found that she was pregnant with a child before they got married. And Joseph had it in his mind, "I'm putting this woman away privately because she has cheated on me. And now she is pregnant with a child from another man." Now, can you imagine a young lady whose world has just been turned upside down with the dreams of getting married and starting a family and starting a life and the festivals that come with marriage, the excitement, and all of a sudden out of nowhere, God says, "I pick you. You are highly favored." And from that encounter, her world begins to turn upside down. The angel of the Lord visits her husband and lets him know, "Listen, this child that's in her is not a man, but it's of the Holy Ghost. I want you to stay with her, marry her. She's going to bring forth a son," so forth, so on. "You're going to call his name Jesus." Listen, Mary lived underneath the shadow of fornication and adultery all of her life. When women looked at her, they looked at her looking down on her. This is the woman who had a child out of wedlock. Even though you and I know the story, the rest of humanity only know this, is that she got pregnant and she wasn't married. I know it's true because when they was talking to Jesus, they said, "At least we weren't born out of fornication." He's 30 years old. And you're talking about what you think that his mama did. Now you think about the price tag, the brokenness, the hurt, the shame, the pain that this woman carried in her life to do the will of God. Her name was talked about. And not only the personal things that she went through, but to her, this was her baby that died on that cross. "I don't care how old you get, you're going to be my baby. I don't care how old my kids get, that's still going to be my baby." Can I get some parents in here tonight? "I don't care if you're 60 years old, that's still my baby." Amen. When he died on that cross, that's still her baby. Her heart. Listen, when my kids just go off for a few hours, Maddie going to go to Jonesboro or Paragould, I'm telling you, the whole time she's gone, no matter what me and her mama are doing, our hearts and our minds are thinking about it. Are you hearing me? Can you see the price that Mary paid to do the will of God in her life?
The scripture text that I use tonight, the Apostle Paul, I don't know if you know this or not, but he was a highly respected religious leader of his day. He sat in one of the highest seats of honor among the people. If you was going to look at somebody in a position of honor, you looked at Saul. He was highly respected. He was trained at the feet of Gamaliel, one of the greatest scholars of that time. And yet when he had his encounter with Jesus, he lost all of that. People thought he lost his mind. He lost his standing in society. People who used to pat him on the back is now staying far away from him simply because God said, I want to use you for my glory. See, every person that's ever been used by God has always had a price tag to pay to reach the destiny. And there's going to be people who die and go into the grave and they never reach their destiny because they're not willing to pay the price that is standing before them. They're not willing to suffer. They're not willing to do what God wants them to do, that God can use them for his glory. If you're going to be used by God, you're going to have a price tag to pay. Let me tell you what Paul said about this. He said, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm a pure Jew. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin, a real Hebrew. I was a member of the Pharisees who demanded the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. He said, I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. But what things were gained to me, those I count lost for Jesus Christ. Now I need you to look at this. Paul took the high standings that the world had to offer, and he laid every bit of that down at the foot of the cross that God could use him for his glory. He didn't care about worldly fame. He didn't care what men thought about him. He said, whatever God I got to do to be used by you, I'm willing to pay that price. Why? Because there's always a price tag to pay to be used by the Spirit of God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? See, some of us in here tonight, we feel it. We know it. I'm not preaching something strange to you. God's already talked to you what you need to do to go to the next level. I'm preaching to somebody in here tonight. All I'm doing is being an echo of what God has already been dealing with you about. Because you know that there's something that stands before you that you got to deal with. I got to deal with this. Why? God is wanting to use me for his glory. God visited Abraham. And he said, Abraham, he said, I'm going to make a covenant with you. Thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy name anymore be called Abram, but thy name shall be called Abraham. For the father of many nations have I made thee. Abraham was barren, Sarah was barren. And God said, I'm going to use you, Abraham. I pick you. I choose you to use you for my glory. Somebody say glory. I'm going to make a mighty nation out of you, Abraham. Out of your barrenness, out of your weakness. I'm going to use you. And I'm going to make a mighty nation. Now watch this. And then all of a sudden the Bible said, and it came to pass after these things, that God did tempt Abraham and said unto Abraham, behold, here I am. And he said, take now thy son, thy only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the mount of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon the mountains which I will tell of thee. And Abraham arose up early in the morning, saddled his ass, and took two of the young men with him. And Isaac his son, and clave the wood for burnt offering, rose up, went into the place which God had told him. So here it is. They finally have this little cute baby boy, and they name him Isaac. This is the fulfillment. Hallelujah. We got a baby. This is a special baby. Why? Because it was a baby between him and Sarah. The other child came from Hagar. Amen. It wasn't his. This is him and Sarah. This is a special boy right here. God visits him. Says, I want you to take that boy and I want you to sacrifice him up on Mount Moriah. Oh, what a wrestling match there had to be in Abraham's heart. I love this boy. I don't want to kill this boy. There had to be a wrestling match. If he's a man, there was a wrestling match. I love this boy. But there's something weighing on Abraham that God wanted to use him. And somehow, some way, Abraham crossed the bridge and he said, I'll pay the price that God wants me to pay. He took that only son up to Mount Moriah and he tied him upon that altar. And that old boy looked around and said, Daddy, where's the sacrifice? I see the wood, I see the fire. Where's the sacrifice? The Bible said that Abraham took the knife. There had to be something in Abraham that was dying that day. Oh, come on. When your baby's sick, wouldn't you rather be sick than your baby? When we went through that ordeal with Maddie, amen, I prayed to myself. I'd tell the Lord. I said, Lord, put it on me. Put it on me. Don't let my baby hurt. Put it on me. Abraham, somehow, somewhere, he was dying on the inside as he wrapped the ropes around the boy to keep him on the altar. What was he doing? He was paying the price for God to use him. He said, God, I'll pay the price because I can't get the promise. I can't fulfill my destiny unless I pay the price that's before me. Can I tell you, anybody that's ever going to be used by God, you got to pay a price. There's a price that stands before you. The Lord came to Abraham and said, because you did not withhold thy only son, I shall establish my covenant with you. And he said, and you're going to be a father of many nations. Amen. See, he got the call. Amen. But he didn't get the fulfillment until he paid the price. There was a price tag there. Come on, somebody. I said there was a price tag there. Amen. It was Jesus that prayed, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. I got news for you, friend. Jesus didn't die on Calvary. No. He died in the Garden of Gethsemane. Yes, he did. When he was wrestling with his wind, and he knew the price tag that stood before him. If I'm going to do what God sent me into the world to do, I got to die. Yeah, he was fighting with it. He was battling. He said, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He said, I don't want to pay this price. I don't want to die. I don't want to go to that level. I don't want to have to give this up. I don't want to have to pay that kind of price. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Every one of us in here tonight that's going to be used by God, there's a cup to drink. There's a price to be paid. Every one of us tonight that's going to be used by God and go to that place that we feel in our heart that God wants us to go to, there's a price. Lift your hands and love him. Lift your hands and love him. Jesus said, the disciple is not above his master. Say it with me. The disciple is not above his master, and nor the servant above the Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call of his household? In other words, what Jesus is saying is that the servant is not above the master. And if the master's got to do it, then the servant's got to do it. No, are you hearing me? Jesus had to pray. He rose up early to pray. He paid a price in prayer that God can use him. If Jesus had to pray, then the servant's got to pray. Jesus fasted 40 days before he ever started his ministry. He fasted 40 days. He paid a price. the master fasted, so must the servant fast too. Many will die without ever reaching their destiny. Many will die and never experience what God really wanted to do through their life because they weren't willing to pay the price that stood before them. Do you realize tonight what God is wanting to do through you? What great thing that lies on the other side of the thing that God is asking you to lay down or kill or pay the price in this area? Do you have any idea? The revival, the miracles that can happen in your life. There was a preacher, and many of you know it. His name is David Wilkerson. And he tells a story of how that when his ministry took off, they started filling all these stadiums up. They had big 18-wheelers full of equipment. They had bands that traveled with them. His face was on billboards everywhere. And he said that, man, the ministry was really taking off. He said, but I found that I wasn't praying. And I didn't have time to walk with God. And he said, I started drying up on the inside. He said, I was miserable on the inside. Outside, I was successful as far as the world is concerned. But on the inside, I knew I wasn't walking with God like I needed to walk. And David Wilkerson's testimony was that he shut every bit of it down. They sold the 18-wheelers, got rid of the big band, got rid of the lights, never went on television again, never went that route. You know what he did? He laid down the idols of this world, and he got back to prayer, and he said, God, I'll pay any price, but I got to have you to use me. Pay the price for God to use you. The price stands before you. Or how long will you wrestle with the decision? How long will you try to go on and knowing that there is a price that stands before you? There's a price that stands before the church if God is going to use us for it. Will you pay the price in prayer for God to use you? Will you pay the price in prayer? The greater the price, the greater the glory. The greater their impact. The more you're willing to pay, the greater anointing. Salvation's free. The anointing's not free. There's a price tag on the anointing. I know saved people that ain't anointed because they don't pay a price tag in prayer to get the anointing on their life. Are you willing to pay the price in prayer to get the anointing on your life? That'll change the atmosphere in the church. That'll break the strongholds in your family. That'll take you from one level to the next level. Can I tell you, I have not seen what God wants to do in your life. You listen, you even haven't even thought on that level of what God can do to a man or a woman that sells out. Will you pay the price in fasting? For God to use you. I want more of you, God. God says, I want more of you. We sing, I want more of you, God. And the Holy Ghost is saying, I want more of you. Pour out. Surrender. Pay the price. Because I want to do something in you. You're a chosen vessel. Get out of that lethargy. Get out of that deadness. Get out of that dryness. Get out of the world. You're a worldly Christian. Get out of the world. Pay the price that I can use you for my glory. I'm not through preaching, but standing, give God a chance. Can't you pray? Can't you pray? Can't you pray? Pay the price that God can use you. Can't you? You mean you can't push a cheeseburger back for one day? You mean you can't lay down food for one day? There are people who pray, pay great prices for God to use them. I remember a young man that was mightily used of the Lord. He had an NFL contract for the Chicago Bears, playing professional football on a high level. And God got pulling on his heart. And he said, take the fame, take the jersey, take all of that. I got to do what God wants me to do. And all you got to decide is whether you're going to quit smoking weed or not. All you got to decide is whether you're going to quit popping the pills or not. You're going to lay down the booze or the cigarettes, or will you pay the price that Jesus can use you for his glory? Everybody's got a price tag that's before them, and I pray in the name of Jesus, help us to pay the price that stands before us. Somebody lift your hands. Somebody lift your hands. You say you want miracles? Pay the price. You say you want God to use you? Pay the price. Say you want dreams and visions? Pay the price. Say you want the anointing? Pay the price. Say you want the glory of God? Pay the price. I never forget. We were talking about Baby Emerson, and we asked him, well, what's she going to be when she grows up? And Maddie said, oh, she's going to be a softball player. And my first response was, no, she's going to be a cheerleader. And all of a sudden, the Holy Ghost smote my heart. He said, what happens about just separating her unto me? Well, she's not a cheerleader. She's not a softball player. She's not a pool shark. She's not a card shark. But she's a woman of prayer. She's a woman of fasting. Say, all the other kids are dressed up and they're going there and they're doing this. Amen, Baby Emerson, what is she doing? She's getting alone with God. Amen, but there's signs, wonders following her life. Quit trying to be like the world and expect God to use you. Quit trying to be like everybody else and expect God to use you. Come out from among them and be ye separate. When I get alone in a prayer closet, he comes and he speaks to me and he shows me things. I remember one time I was praying. I said, I want to know the God of Daniel. And then the Holy Ghost spoke and said, then do what Daniel did. I want to know the God of Elijah. Holy Ghost said, do what Elijah did. Maybe I'm only preaching to one person in here. I don't know. I don't know if everybody knows what a call of God is or feels the call of God. I don't know about this hour, but I know what happened to me when I got saved. I felt something deep down in me pulling my guts out. Amen. I knew there was something special in my life. Amen. And this world could not compare to what God wanted to do in me. And can I tell you, I got a word for you. There's still a price tag before me. There's still a price tag before you. Why? Because you go from one level to the next. You go from one level to the next. I was praying years ago. And I asked the Lord, I said, God, I want you to use me. Oh, God, where's the hearts that cry? God, I want you to use me. Has it become something that stink in the church? It's died off. Men and women and young people that still cry. God, I want you to use me for your glory. Is that prayer still being uttered in the church today? God, I want you to use me for your glory. Live in me, live through me, Jesus. Use me for your glory. I wonder if there's still a person, if there's one in here tonight that says, God, use me. Use me for your glory. God's looking for a vessel. He's looking for a man that'll pay the price. He's looking for a woman that'll pay the price. That'll forget the world. Forget the fame and the lights. Better get along with God and pay the price. That God can use them. There's a price tag to the anointing. There's a price tag to be used by God. I remember when I was a new convert, I was praying for the Lord to use me. And I remember so vividly that the Lord asked me, are you willing to suffer? Because see, in my mind, I was thinking, the Lord, use me. I'm going to be a big-time preacher, or I'm going to pray for the sick and raise the dead. I was thinking something big. And all of a sudden, I hear the small, still voice of the Holy Ghost that says, are you willing to suffer for me? Are you willing to be hated for my namesake and misunderstood? Are you willing to walk alone? And all of a sudden I realized, to be used by the Lord, there's a price tag on it. You can't do what other people do and be used by God. You can't go where other people go and be used by God. And I know in the name of Jesus that there's something kicking in somebody's spirit tonight that God's called you. You know God's called you. Lift your hands and love the Lord. He said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. Let me ask you something as we get ready to pray. How much of yourself are you willing to deny? How much are you willing to deny? How much of yourself are you willing to deny for God to use you? How much are you willing to deny? Because the level of your denial depends on the level of the glory. Your level of denial depends on the level of anointing in your life. I'm going to tell you now, I need you to hear me. Please hear this. The devil didn't set the boundary on this church. We set it. We set it when we refused to pay the price that's before us. It's not the devil that stopped revival. It's us that stopped revival. besides myself? Who am I preaching to? Is there anybody that feels what I'm preaching? Go down. Oh, my son, no glory. Oh, God. Who's coming to this altar and say, God, please give me the strength to pay the price that stands before me. Lord, help me to pray in that level that you want me to pray. Help me to fast in that level that you want me to fast. Help me to live in holiness to that level you want me to live. Help me to pay that price. Where's the cry? Use me for your glory. Use me for your glory. Please use me for your glory. I'm not being mean tonight. But I don't know if you feel what I'm preaching, if you're not crying and weeping and reaching out. I'm not being I appreciate everyone. But there's no way you can feel this and not be broken in your heart to know what stands before you and how weak you are and how much I need God to help me to pay that price. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Do I have a woman in here who's willing to pay the price to be an intercessor for the anointing to get on you to break things in the realm of the Spirit, to take this church to another level in the realm of the Spirit? Why? You paid the price that God could use you in intercessory prayer. Where's the man that's willing to pay the price for the gift of healing to work through him? God wants to use. I remember it made me my wife and my father-in-law may remember, but they prayed for my dad when we first got saved. And his hands would turn bloody red, and oil would begin to fall off of his hands. And I remember my dad being so freaked out by it, because anytime he'd get ready to pray for somebody, and he thought he had the gift of healing on him, and his hands get blood red, and all of a sudden, oil would just start coming up on his hands. I was praying, and the Lord laid this on me about 3 weeks ago. I just ain't been released to preach it till tonight. But I got thinking about that. I said, Lord, what happened to my dad? Because I remember his hands getting just oily and red, and they would have spots all over them from the heat and the anointing that was in his hands to pray for people. And the Lord spoke and said he didn't pay the price to continue to walk in that, because I called him to pay a price, but he stopped. And when he stopped, the anointing stopped. It lifted off of him. I don't know about you. I don't want to come to the edge of the promised land and see it and not cross over. I want to pay that price. How about you? Do I got anybody in here that wants to pay that price? I need somebody praying. I need somebody praying. I need somebody in the Holy Ghost praying. I need somebody travailing. I need somebody's head up underneath the pew somewhere. Barely praying. Barely praying. Barely praying. I need somebody's head up underneath an altar somewhere. Barely praying.